$450 is great.
That's fantastic. Man, sign me up. Oh man, you can't hear that. I'm not sure if we've if Christine's gonna roll that pre-roll music or not, but in the background, Juna's just playing this. Well, I'll tell you about it.
She will play it, yes.
Oh great. Juna's playing, well, I'll tell you about it. It's exciting.
You can tell me about it.
I will. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Tuesday Night Jazz at the Church. My name is Kelly McNair. We are broadcasting live from our respective homes, myself here in Fernwood, and my very special guest this evening, the one and only P-Dog Diddy Dowse, Peter Dowse, my daughter Juno. Peter is the wonderful bass player who actually you hear right now playing on this recording every time you tune in to Tuesday Night Jazz at the Church. This is Peter's sound. Yeah, now Peter has lent his sound to countless groups worldwide over many, many years. And I'm just so glad to get the chance to sit down with him and hang out tonight for Tuesday Night Jazz at the Church. Thank you so much for joining us. And I think Christine's just going to fade this incredible trumpet solo from Miguelito down as we welcome Peter into the house. Peter, welcome. Thank you so much for joining us. How are you doing?
I'm doing great, Kelby. I didn't know that was us playing. I thought, wow, who's that? I don't know who that is.
Uh-huh.
It sounded really good.
Yeah, so that was from the second to last Tuesday Night Jazz at the Church that we did on March 11th.
I remember that.
You were playing bass.
That was and
so I'm just going to start right off with, so everyone, this is Peter. Peter is one of my dearest friends and one of the most swinging bass players I have ever had the chance to play with. How do you do it, Peter? How do you swing so hard? What is it that makes it feel so good?
I think it's a lot of years of trying to sort of establish that, you know. It took a long time to do. I mean, I had that feel for a long time, since I was young, but I think just a constant search, listening to albums like all these great baseball players and wondering why it sounded that great and why I didn't sound that good, you know, and just constantly playing along with all of those albums in that style, especially the jazz records, just playing along with them all day long, you know, 8 hours a day. And and it's finally starting to pay off, you know, especially in the playing standards.
Interesting. So in a nutshell, if I'm getting what you're saying, you find something that feels great, that you love the feel, and then you figure out how to bring that feeling into you by feeling it at the same time with the record until you can replicate it in that same good way.
Yeah. And it's a very strange thing. It's just something that hits me. Like when I was as a teenager, you know, obviously the Beatles were and still are a huge influence on me. Paul on bass had that great feel and he made everything sound so great. I copied him so much, you know, in my early years. And I still go back and listen to him all the time and just wonder like, wow, you know, everything sounds so great because he had that feel. So I was always sort of attracted to a feel kind of a thing more than a, technique way of playing, if you know what I mean. I wasn't so interested in as many notes as I was in the actual feel, especially between all the the bass, how that sort of mixes with the drums and all the other instruments, you know, and how that makes it, how that all happens. And the bass is a big sort of a part of that and just has to sit, you know, nicely in that little pocket. And, you know, it was a real puzzle for me because, especially when I was younger, because I knew what it was. I knew what I was hearing, but I was a bit young and I didn't know how to do it. So it took a long time of practicing and just playing with records, putting the record on, playing along with it. And I go, yeah, I've got it, you know.
Yeah, well, a wonderful pianist told me once that, you know, a good piano player should make you want to play the drums. And I feel that, you know, a good drummer should make you want to dance. And I feel like a good bass player is the thing that really makes the dancing happen somehow. It's like, for me as a drummer, if I can sort of dance on top of that bass feel, then everything is just golden, and you don't have to do anything. You just hang out in that zone. But and you create that for me and so many other groups. It's a really it's an interesting thing that you share, that you bring to the table.
It is a magical thing. And, you know, especially working with you, Kelby, not that I mean, I love playing with everybody who I can, but working with you in this, especially in this, I recognize where I hear you. I know where I can fit in because you have a similar style, or you have that ability to hear where that pocket is, you know? And so I try and fit in there and you recognize it, you know? So we can set that all up for everybody else. And then everyone else in the band just goes, oh, this is feeling great. If you understand what I mean.
Yeah, I see what you're saying. Because I guess it's true, right? Like every bass player on different records or different in different towns, you know, they all find that thing that they love, just like you've done. But because as each of us as individuals, we express the time in a different way. So there's a chemistry, a reciprocal chemistry dynamic.
Yeah, it's like a give and take. You know, I know that sometimes it doesn't seem to lock, you know. And then sometimes I have to say to myself, well, maybe I'm forcing it too much, you know. Maybe I need to just sit back and I should just listen, see where Kelby is, or you know, either Damien Graham or whoever I'm playing with, just sit back and listen for a while, see where they are, and then try to fit in and find where they are. So that takes a lot of intuition, you know, and just listening, which is something that was hard for me to do when I was young, because I was younger. I just wanted to play, you know, and I think as I've gotten a lot older, I'm able to say, hold on a minute, you know, just sit back, listen to where everything is, and you know how to get into there, you know, just let it happen, and then it works. And then usually by that time, you're into your thing, and we play along great. And then all the guys who are playing with us are having a great time because we've set it up for them.
Well, I'll tell you what, we got into the meat and potatoes right off the hop here. Let's let's see a little bit, because I'm really curious as what you've brought us in your playlist. So let's find out a little bit about what sound you fell in love with that gave you this sense. So tell us about the first clip you brought.
Yeah, I'm going to go with age, really, because when I was younger, I was definitely influenced by Beatles and British rock. I loved it. It was amazing. But I think I got to a certain age by around like 18. I mean, I had heard Hendrix and everything in his early bands, and it was fantastic, but I didn't really like it. And one night, somebody was playing a band of gypsies. No, that's not the tune. That's Curtis Mayfield. But you should see like Isabella. And this tune is Isabella by Jimi Hendrix. And what was happening is that the bass, he had a new bass player. And they were playing these lines along with each other. And it was just so powerful and the driving like a train, you know? And I'd never heard that before. And it was like something just hit me over the head. It's like, oh my God, what is that? And so I went out and I bought myself a bass just like his bass, and I started learning all the stuff from this album. So, and you can really hear where Hendrix and the bassist, Bill Cox, they lock and they play this line over and over again, and they just play this nice rhythmic line together, and it just makes a great feel. And that's kind of where I jumped off into R&B, really. And I kind of left the rock out for a little while. So, So a lot of like 16th notes and and I'd never really heard that before, you know, Kelby. And so it started really with that Hendrix R&B thing. And you know, I was still playing in a lot of the groups at that time, bands in town, but we nobody was really into that. I just played that at home. You know, when I would go home, I would just start to learn that.
And so hang on, tell us, where is home at this point? Where are you in your Montreal life journey? Okay. So yeah. Does England factor into this for you in your musical development? So people who don't know you, I didn't tell a whole lot of your bio at the beginning, but so you were born in England in a musical household, and then go from there. Take us a little snapshot for a moment.
Little snapshot. But my mom was a concert pianist. I had lots of classical at home as a youngster. My mom would sit me in front of the stereo, and I would listen to all kinds of stuff. And she would, I started to learn how to recognize intervals, chords, and how the bass could set up different chords and things like that. She taught me all that. And I was very young. I was probably like 5 or 6, listening to all that stuff. And so, living in England, jazz was not really really big in England at that time. It may have been in some areas, but it was mainly sort of Dixieland bands and things like that. It wasn't really big in England. I remember that pop started to come in. And once I got to a little bit older and the Beatles hit, I didn't want to know any more about, I didn't want to know any more about that stuff. So it was just, Beatles, and then probably by the time, I think when I was 13, we came to Canada, and I was a teenager and got into bands all around in the West Island of Montreal. And,
So you had a bass when you were in England before you were 13, or you didn't get that till you moved to Montreal?
I had a guitar in Montreal, in England, but I was playing bass on it. I really was interested in bass. I really liked it. I liked what it used to do, like the way that it moves through different chords, and you can play different notes with the same chord and it'll just alter that chord. I really liked that. So I want to play bass, but I didn't have a bass until we came to Canada, probably by the time I was 14. I met some guys at school once I, gotten established here a bit, and I wanted a bass, and my mom, she bought me a bass. And
so tell me about this bass. This was an electric bass?
It was an electric bass. It was a cheap sort of copy of a Hofner bass that Paul had, like violin style. It was blue. Pyramid was the name of the brand. Very cheap. It was $80.
Yeah, that sounds good.
And I had a sticker on it, this flower. It was like a yellow flower. Nice big sticker on it, because that was the days of, flower power was in, And I played in a Beatle band. We played the Beatles, Doors, all kinds of stuff. And then all of a sudden I started to jam around, and I met all kinds of people. And I'll just zoom ahead so that we can quickly get on. Probably when I got a little bit older, I was finding that I moved to Ontario and got involved in a band once I left school, because I did leave school to play in the band, actually, unfortunately. But I went to Ottawa, and there was a band, there was an R&B band with horns. And I had to audition for that band and got in, and it was like 6 nights a week, up and down the 401 from Hamilton back to Ottawa, to Toronto, just playing in all these hotels and Holiday Inns. And I started to hone my skills that way. So, but that was a little bit later. That was after I'd gotten into Hendrix, and after that record that you just heard, and probably after the next one, I was still at home while listening to Curtis Mayfield a lot too, because that I saw them on TV. Curtis Mayfield came on with Freddie's Dead, and that was probably about, that was before I left to go to Ottawa, and I was really getting into this way of playing. And so maybe you want to hear a little bit of that song.
Yeah. Now, is this from Superfly?
It's from the
movie.
Superfly.
Yeah. Okay.
And there's also that song too, that's a song too. So, you know,
let's check a little of them both out.
Right. So this is kind of it goes down that same avenue from Hendrix, really. It sort of has that same R&B feel, you know.
Such a beautiful world with a wonderful girl. Ooh, I need a woman child. Don't wanna be like Freddy now, because Freddy's dead.
Yeah, that's a beautiful groove, Peter.
So, and that, you know, and around that time, so this is before I joined that soul band. At that same time, television was coming on, and a lot with these great themes, you know. And one of the themes from Sanford and Son, every time it came on the TV, I would stick my ear to the TV and try to listen to them, you know, because the bass was so it was just, you know, bouncing all over the place. And I didn't know who these players were, you know. And I found out later, of course, you know, the Chuck Rainey was the bass player on that, who became a huge, big fan of I became a big fan of his. And this again is just such great bass playing, you know, and he does all kinds of slides and licks, and I don't know why it appealed to me. I don't know. It was just something that appealed to me. You know, just, I love this feel of it and the sound.
Yeah, man.
So, and that bounce, that bass is just really bouncing a lot all over the place, you know. And you know, I was still in bands at that time, playing, you know, British rock like Yes and things like that around back. But at home, I would come home and I just learn that, you know, by myself. I just really sort of gravitated towards that. Anyway.
Well, there's something so special though when I hear that playing, it's like you say, it's bouncy, but there's such a beautiful thing that you do. And that bass player, I'm sorry, it was Chuck Rainey, did you say?
Chuck Rainey, who became a really huge influence. Yeah.
And so the way you two both articulate, like the long notes, the short notes, that for me as a drummer, that makes me want to dance because, you know, it doesn't take up too much space sonically, but it's got this huge rhythmic like life and energy to it. And that's one of the things that I noticed that you do just so well. And I wonder, is that just for you, that's just part of the sound, that's just part of the story, part of the drama, right? Like the way you shape the lines.
Yeah. But you have to understand at that time in my life, at that age, I knew what it was, but I couldn't play it yet. I had to just sit with it, you know, for so long and try to understand how to play it. I was attracted to it, but I couldn't play it.
Cool.
I started to get there, you know. It was a long journey, but yeah, I totally understand.
So tell me about what's next. So you're living at this time, you're a young man, you're on the scene in Montreal, you're playing. Oh no, are you in Montreal at this point?
Well, I'm not this is before I left to go on the road and all that stuff. I'm still basically living at home and in just other jamming around. It was a very interesting thing because there was many, the 1970s opened up many avenues for everyone, for other players to go down. And I had some other friends on another street who were into jazz, but into jazz fusion, but I didn't understand, I didn't know what it was at the time. And, I was still at home. And one day, this guy said, you've got to hear this album, Tony Williams Lifetime with John McLaughlin from England, you know, this guitar player. But Bitches But Brew, from which is Miles, had been out. I hadn't heard that. It had been out for about a year or two. And I went to his place and listened to this stuff. And then he played me John McLaughlin's album, In a Mounting Flame, also. And it was just, I'd never heard it before. I wasn't quite ready for it. It was just so intense. I mean, this was all those great jazz players from the 60s who all of a sudden, you know, they wanted to play something new. They wanted to mix with rock, you know. And so this opened up a whole new thing for me.
Awesome. Let's check it out. This is
a little bit of it. It does get intense.
Okay. Well, you give us a signal.
I'll give you a signal. We'll be right back. Anyway.
Cool. So tell me what grabbed you about this? What changed the shape of sound for you?
I didn't like it.
Okay.
And I didn't like it at all. I was happy in my little R&B bubble and my Hendrix bubble. And it was like thrown upon me. There was also the Chick of Korea, and Herbie Hancock had also started his Headhunters band. And my friend said, "You're going to come down and see a show, you know, and you're going to come down and see the Mahavishnu Orchestra, you know." And he bought me a ticket. And I said, "Okay, I'll go with you." So I went to see them, and I was blown away. And because it was a total departure from what I was into. I had to learn about time, that they were playing time signatures that I didn't understand. You know, I was just to play like R&B, it's just like straight ahead. And these guys were playing like, you know, like 17/8 and all that kind of stuff. And it was exciting to listen to, extremely exciting to listen to. And yeah, maybe we can check out just a little bit of it, not too long, you know, because it gets a little long. But Cobb.
The bass player, Rick Laird, is that right?
Yeah, Rick Laird. He's an Australian bass player, and he didn't stick out. I mean, I wasn't attracted by the bass. I think what, you know, I was this, I was kind of a sponge, you know, like we all are, I think, when we're kids. And I got influenced by a lot of people who knew about those kind of things. And I thought, well, if he thinks it's really good, I should go listen to it. But then I understood that it was really good. You know, I thought, wow, this music it's important, you know? And so I soaked it up, and not for the bass really so much, but for the direction that music was heading at that time. The 1970s were a huge change and a departure for jazz players, especially. Now, the jazz players, they wanted to get away from it. People like, I guess, Miles, they wanted to try, you know, other things. They were listening to Sly and the Family Stone, the John McLaughlin, you know, the Tony Williams, of course, you know, they wanted to just go crazy, you know, and play with rock players and do all kinds of things. So there was this whole new thing starting. And It was very exciting. I was intimidated because I didn't understand. I didn't quite know what it was, you know, but I knew that it was something very special. Not for the bass, but for the rhythm of the drums, especially of Cobham, of Billy Cobham. I don't know if you know Billy Cobham, great drummer. He was fantastic in that band. And of course, John himself is just so fantastic. And so, of course, this whole thing started jazz fusion. And so, you know, not only did I have the R&B thing going, and I had now this new jazz thing going, and my ears were just open to everything. You know, it was a very interesting time. I still wasn't really playing at that time in a major band. I did have we had a little band that used to practice all that stuff. The John McLaughlin, the Chick Corea, which I don't think I didn't give you a Chick Corea song. I don't think I gave you one. Yeah, Hymn of the Seventh Galaxy. But we don't really have, just play, I mean, it's very similar. It's very hard-edged. Just these other jazz players just wanting to play rock, you know. And maybe we can just play like about 30 seconds. It's really, but this was all happening at that time. And I went to see all these bands playing all this music. You know, you don't really have to play it if you don't want to.
Let's check it out.
Just for a minute, you know, because it does get intense. So yeah, like all these young guys, you know, I guess, you know, Chick Corea was younger then, and, you know, they're all just experimenting and playing a lot of that kind of music. So all these bands, I was going down to see all these groups playing that because they would come to Montreal, you know.
And so contextualize this for us. So for those of us who used to come to, you know, like Tuesday Night Jazz at the church, we come to a little beautiful church space, you know, we'd fit like 120 people max. What kind of rooms were these musicians playing? So like as a jazz player, Chick Corea, then moving into fusion, what was the, you know, the sonic difference is huge, but what were the venues like too?
Okay, this show and John McLaughlin and Herbie Hancock, they all came to a place called Place des Arts, which was a huge big theater. You know, it's like a Red Cedar, probably you know, like these large rooms, more than, you know, like about like 500 seaters.
Okay.
And so, you know, because they were huge. They were the new, they were on par with any of the rock bands that were starting to tour at that time, you know, like, it was a new thing. And it was huge. So they were playing big venues. Herbie Hancock came there too. And I was very excited by Herbie Hancock because Herbie Hancock was, you know, he was in that more of the vein that I was more excited about of playing the R&B. And not that I didn't like Stanley Clark. Stanley Clark is an amazing bass player, but.
Stanley Clark, bassist with Return to Forever, yeah?
With Return to Forever. And also, he was a solo artist, too. One thing I think that's important to just establish is that I was a kind of a bass player that always enjoyed sort of being a part of something, sort of, you know, I didn't want to be out in the front, you know, and I think I'm still that way today. So bass soloists, I mean, I like to listen to bass solos and strong bass players. We're always excited to listen to, but I was always I liked the way that it hooked up with everything else, you know. So that the bass player with Herbie Hancock at that time was more of a bass player that just like sat back, you know, and just played the R&B style, you know, bass. And so that got me right away. I thought, oh God, that guy's great, Paul Jackson.
All right, let's check it out. So this is from, I forget, when was this album? Was this 70?
73.
Okay. And this is from the Headhunters. So you were saying that you felt that that was a little more like home base for you in terms of its sensibilities around maybe a little more like groove and kind of sonically for R&B roots for you?
Yeah. Yeah. Yes. I think that it was like speaking to me a bit more than other things I was listening to at that time. So that was a very, very important part of my growth, was hearing Paul Jackson play with Herbie Hancock. Yeah, and he was from Oakland, and there was an Oakland sound that was really, you know, very, that R&B sound. It was, yeah.
Cool. Now, sorry, when you talk about...
This is very exciting for me.
Yeah. So when you talk about something like an Oakland sound, so I know you spent a lot of time also traveling in the U.S. and touring and spending a lot of time in not only Canadian, but many, many American cities. So where are you at this time in your career? Have you started traveling at this point, or were you still kind of putting all these influences in your head back in Montreal?
Yeah, this was all just part of my growth. I mean, I think, you know, we spent quite a bit of time here just sort of in my years before I really went out to play in bands where I was earning some money and playing six nights a week. So this was really where I just honed those skills to be able to get into those bands, you know? So with that, I probably the next few years touring with this band and a few other groups, and I got a little bit older, you know, in my 20s, and I came back to Montreal and, you know, play around a lot, get involved in some studio sessions. You know, it was just the beginning at that time. It wasn't really starting then, but I was playing around a lot. So there was a lot of great places to play at that time in probably the later 70s, you know, mid to late 70s. And, musicians like Bob Mover, a great tenor and alto player. I don't know if you know him.
Just by name.
Yeah, but Bob Mover is a sax player from Florida, from Miami, I believe. And he's quite famous. But anyway, he lived in Montreal for quite a long time, and I would play in his band a lot. We used to play at this place called the Rainbow, and they would just let you play. So, and a lot of the jazz players, at that time now, we're moving on a bit now into the mid to later 70s, there were players who were playing, you know, straight ahead, but there were a lot of the jazz players who wanted to do this more experimenting stuff, you know, and they were writing their own tunes, or they were playing standards that were peculiar, you know, that were odd. And I fit into that. It was perfect because, you know, I mean, I couldn't read. Unfortunately, I taught myself to read a bit later, but I could hear what they wanted to play. So I was able to fit into those things. So we had a lot of fun, probably playing in Montreal as I got a bit older, just playing around and doing a lot of those kind of, there wasn't quite the jazz. You know, they were jazz players, but I wasn't. And I was playing with people like Steve Hall was another great horn player, another great guy. And they were all into Coltrane, and you know, they knew all that stuff. But they wanted to play a bit more of the modern stuff. And I kind of was able to fit into that. And I was lucky that I was able to do that.
Beautiful. So tell us about the next tune you've got coming up. We've got Hidden Shadows.
That's just another Herbie tune that I just, you know, is a, yeah, we don't really have to play that. Actually, that one, we can move on from that one.
Okay. You've got Stanley Clark up next. Is that,
yes,
is that a place you want to go?
Yeah. Like just a little bit of Lobster Lute. Like he was a great solo player and he became quite a star by himself. So I did learn a lot of Stanley Clark stuff. He was really the first bass player, electric player, to be really out there before the Jackal came out and to say, hey, you know, this is electric bass. And so, of course, I learned everything he did, you know, at that off this album. But we can play maybe a minute or so of Lopsy Lou. And I learned this. And every bass player learned it, you know. I mean, it was part of that time. So this is probably still back around 73, 74, but it was part of my repertoire. I think that's...
I'm so glad you brought that in, Peter.
That's Tony Williams actually on drums on that one.
It's beautiful.
So I said, oh my God, okay, here's something else I'm going to have to learn how to do. So, you know, it all became part of the sort of a package that I was able to do, you know, and yeah. Where are we going?
I don't know. Let's see. So this is kind of a bit of an adventure through your history, and I'm really enjoying hearing a lot of the stuff I wasn't expecting you to bring based on my perception of how you play. And I get to play with you in a lot of different contexts. Again, I probably could have talked about this at the very beginning to drop these seeds, but for people who know you, a lot of people might be checking this out from who love you and your work with like a Prince cover band or with a Cuban project or with a more kind of like a Motown kind of vibe or a pop project or a modern jazz thing or a standards project. And you kind of exist a little bit uniquely in our city and here on the West Coast as a player who does exist kind of independently within all those scenes. You know, like some people who know you as a pop bass player might not even know that you play other styles, and vice versa.
That's very interesting you say that. Yeah. Yeah, that is true. Yeah. And you're very right about that.
So I'm enjoying hearing all these things that you brought from your, you know, your history. We got a lot left to hear. So the next thing we got up here is Graham Central Station.
Yeah, just the beginning of it, just until the band comes in. I couldn't figure out how he played it. I played it backwards for a while until I understood where the one was. And I didn't understand that until many years later, until somebody showed it to me properly. But I was terribly intrigued by this bass line. And Larry Graham was the bass player with Sly and the Family Stone, and then he went on his own. And just the first minute or so, that would be great, please. And then, because, you know, I did get into jazz. I really love playing jazz, but this is a very important part of my learning the jazz music, I think, because I think the R&B was a very influential part of it.
Right on. All right, here we go. Graham Central Station, Hair.
Of his hair.
I bet you didn't know where the one was for a while, right? I didn't. Well, I didn't know where the one was. It took me a long time to figure that one out. You know, there was great bass players of Montreal at that time. I mean, and I used to try playing that. Okay, we're like, this is how it goes, and he would say, "No, man, you got it wrong. No, you don't know where the one is." So that was a big learn. Kelby, you know, being a lot older, you know, you can always say that I have a lot of experience, and I always put experience to making a lot of screw ups, you know, like making mistakes, you know, thinking that I have something right and you don't, you know, and people having to tell you, you know, you better go home and start practicing, you know. And I think I had, by this time, I mean, I thought I was doing something great, but I didn't have enough experience really yet to think I had the right stuff. So there was a lot of knocking down going on, you know, having to walk home from gigs, you know, with my tail between my legs. It's like, I didn't get that right.
And so I wanted to ask you just a second. So we talked about your musical development so far as your mom kind of inspiring you to play and inspiring you sonically to check out these ideas about bass lines and how they're made, what they can do in the music. And then did you take any other kind of lessons, or were your lessons all these very honest lessons of finding something you love, trying to figure it out and having people help you? Was it all kind of this way for your musical development?
I have to say, I'm not proud of it, but I was very lazy. I didn't take any lessons, and my mother did try to, you know, encourage that, and bless her. The Beatles, as I said, when I was young, they were coming out. I just wanted to hold a guitar and play it and just be, you know, Paul McCartney, you know, and I could hear it because, I think from a young age, I was able to hear the intervals and the bass line and how bass can move through that. I understood those fundamentals. Rhythmically, I was still a bit weak. That took me a lot longer, and it still is. It's an ongoing thing. But, I knew what music was about. I knew instantly by ear that I could listen to anything on the radio, or I could just play it, you know. So I was lucky enough that I didn't take lessons. I didn't have any lessons, but I sure, when I saw someone that I really liked in town, or any bass player or player, I would definitely hang out with them a lot, and they would show me things, you know. So that's basically how I learned, or by watching another bass player could get up and play something that was better than I could do, and having to go, gosh, you know, I better go home and learn that properly, you know.
Right on.
Using my ears and memory, you know, and wearing out albums and records with this needle just going back and forth over the record, you know. So I didn't take any lessons.
Well, I think that's a really special thing too, just in that for me, you are one of the musicians that I know that I appreciate how important it is for you to memorize a song and arrangement, that reading is not, you know, the paper does not mean music for you, but you like to learn it by ear. And then, you know, the thing is that it's always available to you. You know, I've heard you play arrangements that we haven't played for 5 years or something, and they're all still in there.
Yeah.
You know, I think that's part of the oral tradition of learning the music this way.
Well, I think it's necessity made me do that at a young age, because I didn't take lessons. Because I rebelled against, I just wanted to be a rock musician to play. I just wanted to get on the stage and play. You know, I didn't want to go through all that learning. So I had to make myself learn and try to use my memory in that way. And, you know, I mean, it's paid off. It's been great with you. I mean, I can remember all the tunes that we play. It's great to have that as a tool. I do regret not learning how to read properly at an early age, though. I did teach myself how to read. I mean, I can write out charts now, but it's not great. Yeah.
Oh, no problem. You're in good company in the jazz and pop world. Tell us about Harold Melvin and the Blue Notes.
Well, okay. Now, this is basically, I was beginning to do a lot. I was doing sessions. And just to make a quick thing, I got into the session work industry in Montreal that was doing a lot of jingles and French records. And, you know, because people were seeing me play, and of course they thought I could read. And, you know, I didn't do so well in that area. You know, I did get let go a few times on some of these dates. And luckily, there was one producer who was dealing with a lot of stuff down in New York, and he wanted me to play on some of the disco stuff. And I was like, you know, the disco was becoming in fashion. And, you know, I was enjoying playing, you know, this like fusion R&B kind of stuff. And I didn't really want to play the disco stuff. But I began to get into the disco stuff, and there were some wonderful bass players at that time who were playing, especially in Philadelphia, where Bad Luck, Harold Melvin and the Blue Notes in Philadelphia, which I did a lot of studio work. I did quite a few studio dates in Sigma Sound and Alpha Studios, I'm sorry, down in Philadelphia, because of the records I did a bit later on. We would have to go down there and do all the violins and strings, and I'd have to, that's a bit later on when I was producing stuff. But I was really aware of these wonderful bass players coming out. And one of them is this guy on Bad Luck.
All right, let's check it out.
Okay. Disco.
Losing out on everything you might try to do. bad luck fella's got to hold on you. Cause ain't money about to lose your home. Done lost your woman and everything you own. Love average plain mistakes, the chances go around. And if you wanna know the truth about it, I'll tell you what's wrong with you.
So, yeah, you can see it has that same drive, that syncopation, you know, the 16th notes and that syncopation that the earlier influences I had, it was coming out into early disco music.
Well, tell you what, since we're here at the top of the hour, we always do a little welcome back to people and tell them what we're doing. Why don't, while I do that, do you want to grab a bass and maybe you can... play a little something for us and maybe talk a little bit about when you say something like 16th notes or when you talk about like how to construct a line or making a line that's got a lot of space or maybe a little more bounce to it or busy, or maybe you can show us a little something while I say welcome to everyone.
Sure, I can. You know, I'm going to, it looks like it's dark behind me, so I'm going to open up the...
Okay. So hi, everyone. This is Kelby McNair, and that is the space where Peter Dowse is hanging out. You're listening to Tuesday Night Jazz at the Church, which is our endeavor to connect with you during this COVID season that we're in here. So Tuesday Night Jazz at the Church is a live music setting where we come together in a beautiful space at James Bay United Church, and we hear some great music, and we get to connect with you, the audience. This is a little different. It gives us the opportunity to dive into the history of some of the musicians who make a lot of the music at Tuesday Night Jazz at the Church. And tonight, we have the wonderful opportunity of hearing from bassist Peter Dowse. Now, Peter has probably played on more Tuesday Night Jazz at the Church concerts than anyone else. And the reason is because it feels so good, and he takes care of the music. He takes care of the heart and the soul and the sound. And so we're getting to hear some of what informed his musical development, his history. And right now, we just have the opportunity to say, if you like what you're hearing or you like this work that we're doing, you do have the opportunity to help us make it happen. We started this as a way to make good on our contracts to musicians that we had already contracted with for the rest of March, and we've been able to keep it going. So we get to offer an honorarium to the musicians and get to support this program a little bit. So if you'd like to contribute, please do. But I think there'll be a link that'll be posted for you, but also know that joining us and listening is the best we could ask for. So thanks for being here. Now, Peter Dowse, P-Dog Diddy Dowse, as he's affectionately known, to me anyways. Check it out. So, Peter, we were talking about constructing a bass line. Now, I don't know if you can tell, Peter, but we're missing your eyes here. Is there a way you can maybe scooch? I'm not sure if it's a little forward or back.
Sorry about that.
Oh, no, this is great. This is like reality TV, but real. So when we talk about a bass line, if you were to play a session, like some of the ones you're talking about in Philadelphia or one of the many sessions that you do here, and we were talking about creating a bass line that, you know, maybe, you know, had some space or made you want to dance, can you play just a couple little different sort of ways you might construct, or how different a bass line can be?
Right. Well, first of all, you need that beat, right? So.
Mm-hmm. There it is.
You hear that okay?
Yeah, absolutely.
And then you want to, you know, start some, like a little syncopation in there.
Yeah.
I was there.
Absolutely.
So, now you see, now that's from stealing all from those guys that we've just listened to for a little while. And you know, just to quickly make a segue into jazz, I mean, just knowing and going over all of that syncopation for many years helped me in jazz, because it's all in jazz, bass, playing. All that stuff, it may not be played the same way, it's all there.
Yeah. Absolutely. Okay, so let's see, while you've got it on, I know we're going to talk a little bit about some Latin music. Can you maybe play? So in Montreal, I know you probably got a chance to play. There's such a beautiful world music scene. Every music on the in the world exists in Montreal. And I know we're skipping ahead a little bit, but while you've got the bass on, would you play us a little something maybe that has, you know, that same kind of idea of syncopations and leading tones or harmony, but also from maybe like a Latin kind of vibe or a Cuban or
Right.
perspective.
Sure. Let's see if I can. Oh gosh, now you got me going now.
Or that, you know, oh, so you got one?
Let's. Anyway,
Yeah.
it's kind of rough, but
No, I think it's a great opportunity because, you know, a lot of the time when people hear you play in a context, we don't get to really like take the bass out of it into this context. So to hear how you create the stability and you create the movement, the instability, the push, the pull, however you think about it.
Yeah, and that was another huge learning experience. I didn't learn Latin until really much later, probably in the early 80s, and because being in New York a lot, there's a lot of Puerto Rican influence there, and with the records I was doing, we had to go to Puerto Rico, so I'd never been there before, and we had to open up a show for Celia Cruz and the Fania All-Stars. I had no idea who they were, you know, Ray Barretto and all those guys. And because I was in the first band, I mean, you know, they didn't really want to hear us. All the people were there to see Celia Cruz, which was great for me. I didn't care, but I got to stand on the side of the stage and, I can't remember who the bass player was. It could have been Sal Cuevas, and I stood there and I just was in awe. I mean, we was actually all staying at the same hotel. I remember we all went back together, and they were all in these white suits, and I just got knocked out. And I turned. Every time I turned on like a radio, I would hear this like this beat playing and. Then again, I got led into this area and I just loved it.
Beautiful. Hey, I got a little note that came in here from our dear friend Larry. Larry Leek writes, "Hey Peter, Bob Mover later moved to Toronto, and plays bebop alto sax at light speed tempos."
Ah, thank you. Thank you there. Great.
Thanks for checking it out, and thanks for chiming in, Larry. We're very glad to have you with us.
He
So,
he's
Peter.
he's also on a he's on an Esperanza Spalding video too.
Okay.
Yeah, anyway.
No, it's great. So. I don't know if we want to take off the. Oh, maybe just before we do, maybe you can just lay down a super stock disco bass line so we can just hear you do that while we've got you in this luxurious position.
So you know the bad luck style, I didn't unfortunately a lot of the records that I wanted to play, like the bad luck song that was on earlier by Teddy Pendergrass, but there was another disco style that was just more octaves, and it was just more like you know, so I don't know how many of those records I ended up doing, you know, like. For I probably did, I remember like one night I did like four albums for 150 bucks, you know, with this one producer. I remember he said, okay, yeah, Pete, can you just do that? And then, okay, let's do that in another key. You know, and okay, that's great. And then you know, so I would do all, and we, there was no other drummer. It was just a drum loop of a drummer who I used to play with all the time, Graham Chambers. And they just like snipped a little bit of his playing and they made a loop out of it. Boom, bat, boom, you know. So there was never anybody else. So, you know, I would, this is when the music industry began to take another, you know, started to get a bit weird for me because, you know, 6 months later, I would hear like all these four albums that I had played on, you know, and I didn't know I was playing on four records because it was only the bass and this loop and the producer who was writing the tunes kind of thing on a keyboard or a guitar. And he would just make, you know, just play something, Peter. Okay, great, you know. You know, or something like that, you know, just played over and over again. And I would hear these records coming out, you know. So it was wonderful. It was very exciting. But I found out later that lots of musicians got caught up in that.
Oh, cool. Okay, now, while you still got your bass, just since we got the opportunity, can you just swing a blues for us while we have this? Because to me, I think that part of the, maybe this whole thing is really helping us understand, you know, how your pulse is, to me, so strong when you play, and the way you think the same rhythmic concept, I think, whether you're playing an R&B tune or walk in a jazz bass line, which I think is sort of the
right
part of what's helpful for us to understand. Thank you. Okay, we're going to move into beautiful. We'll keep moving because we got a lot more music to hear. And I also want to ask you at this time, Peter. So while we were listening to that last one, I went through this thing and I found something that you recorded on with me just when we were messing about at Jazz at the Church. So if you tell me, I'm going to list you a few tunes, and if you tell me one of them, I'm going to try to send it to Christine. It's not mastered or anything, but there's a bunch that you can choose from. I'm going to ask you to choose one of those just as an example so we can play something recent that you recorded on. So you just, I'll list them off to you and you tell me if there's one that sticks for you. West End Blues, Ballad Number 4, Love Theme, Before the Egg Cracks, Uprising, Running Song, Farmers, or The Heights. Do any of those tickle your fancy? And I'll send it off.
You pick them out. Maybe the Heights, because that was a blues, wasn't it?
You got it. Yes, it is. Okay, I'll send it over. Okay, now tell us what we got next in the playlist here. We have Everything is Everything, or we have Big Paul. So now we're about to transition sonically into a pretty different landscape.
Well, you see now, yeah. Now this was a time when I was still in Montreal a lot and going out to New York thinking I was, you know, Mr. Big. And there was another area of Montreal where they were still playing a lot of standards.
Okay.
You know, people like Charlie Biddle and all that gang. Wonderful players. It's just that the names don't, you know, they don't come to me very all that quickly right now. But, you know, I didn't know that area, but there were some players who said, Peter, you should go down and try the jamming with those guys. So I did, you know, I asked, I think it was Nelson Simons, a great jazz guitar player from Montreal. I mean, all these guys would play with Oscar Peterson. They were all aware at that time about him and they used to play with him. So they were all playing at different clubs, like they were playing down at Rockheads Paradise. And there was Ivan Simons had his own little jazz bar. So I would go down there and I would get up on stage and I'd learned by now, there were some players that said, Peter, you know, you need to learn some tunes, which we will get into next. And they sort of steered me in the way of a bluesy type of bass that would suit what I was doing, which was great, which was the Hank Mobley Coltrane type style. And I learned one or two tunes, and I figured I could get up on stage there with those guys. And, you know, it was a different thing. All of a sudden, I'm thrown into, like, a Cherokee for 15 minutes. And, I mean, you know, walking off stage, and it's like, you know, That was tough. It was very exciting part. So I had a whole new thing to learn and learn about jazz playing. And you can't just learn a tune off a record and think you're going to get up on stage and play with some guys, because they're not going to play like the record. Yeah, I learned that around that time, Willie Weeks. So, yeah, you'll notice that a lot of the bass style that I choose is not, I haven't mentioned the Jaco Pastorius, who was another fantastic player. And I was influenced by Jaco a lot, but he was a real front man, you know, and he was technically above anything that I think that I could have done. I was more attracted to that kind of more bluesier kind of a sound, like the what we just heard, which was that type of thing. So just to let you know that.
Yeah, it's beautiful. No, I'm loving it. So tell me.
As you said, it's about the dancing. You can hear that the people are being affected by what the bass player is and interacting with the drums, you know. It's about affecting people and making them like move and dance.
Absolutely. Okay, so tell you what, we've got a little bit of time left, but we've got Big Paul and Three Coins in a Fountain. Do you want to hear a little bit of both of those, or do you want to hear one of those and keep moving? Because I'd love to hear a couple of the other tunes that you've got here too.
Sure. Now, of course, Paul Chambers, he became... Somebody, I mean, I didn't know about Paul Chambers, but somebody said that I should really be checking him out, you know, and again, because it comes more from that sound that is very similar to the style that I was interested in, you know. It's not a right upfront sound. It's it's a bass player that really likes to hang in the band, but has a wonderful like woody sound, you know. So I got really attracted to that, and I learned a lot of his stuff line by line, and played along with him. So if you want to check out Big Paul, maybe.
Yeah, beautiful.
There was a wonderful bass player who played electric, didn't play upright, Leon Feigenbaum, a Montreal bass player. Unfortunately, he wasn't that well at that time, but he was the guy who knew all that stuff. And, he would just say, chambers, whatever, Coltrane, So I was very influenced by him. And so he played all that stuff on electric bass, on a Fender Apple Precision bass. And I tried to copy him, I still do.
And so when did this happen in your life? When did you hear this? Because this sort of, it's the same harmony you've been talking about in terms of like classical and pop and those different kind of styles, the same idea rhythmically of moving the beat forward, having it feel good, making you want to dance. But when did sort of jazz bug get in your ear? When did Paul become one of your guys?
Yeah, it's basically around that same disco time. I was still going out and playing with my fusion friends and just having somebody who knew how to play real jazz, like a real standard player. A lot of them did. It was a bit intimidating. I was afraid of jazz. I was scared of jazz, because Alain Caron was a new player in town. He had just moved to Montreal from Victoriaville or somewhere. And he was playing in the same club I was playing. He would play at 5 o'clock in the afternoon. He would play standards on an upright. And I would play at night R&B. And there were these wonderful bass players, like there was Ron Sagan, another fantastic bass player. And I was intimidated. I was afraid of jazz because I hadn't really played it before, and I had tried, and I'd learned a few of these tunes at home, but I didn't know how to do that. This was at that same time, probably late 70s, just again getting a bit of a knock, and just having to go home and just go home and just like woodshed and try playing again with other players. And slowly it started to happen for me, because again I had that same excitement that I had for all the other styles of music I was learning. I became that, had that same that same energy I was putting into learning everything that Paula Chambers was doing. And unfortunately, at that time when I was learning styles, I sort of had, blinders on. I didn't want to hear anybody else. I only wanted to hear Paul Chambers, or Of course, now I'm a lot older. There's so much wonderful music out there. I love everything now. But at that time I was a bit, you get zoned in.
Well, tell you what, we have a few more moments. I'd love to hear maybe Christine, I think, has queued up the Paul Chambers solo in Three Coins in a Fountain. So why don't we check that out and
sure.
See if that can shed a little light on it. So beautiful.
You talk about syncopation, Syncopation.
Yeah.
Syncopation, making it the dance. Paul Chambers,
Absolutely. So, Peter, I want to talk to you a little bit just for a second. If we were going to pick one of these, like I Want to Be Ready or Can't Fake That Feeling, one of these tunes that you were involved in, Come to Me, are these tunes that you were involved in both as a player, as a producer as well? How did you start putting on that hat in a quick version?
These were disco tunes that I played on. These were some of them I selected. Can't Fake the Feeling was a song I was involved with, right from the beginning, involved in producing the, sort of getting the people together in the band, like, Kat Dyson, who later went on to play with Prince, a good guitar player. She's the one who wrote the tune. And I'm still in touch with Kat sometimes. And we had a great time in the studio, and she was a fantastic guitar player and writer and songwriter. And she wrote this tune for Geraldine Hunt, who we were in the studio with at that time. So that was kind of a big one. I know we're running out of time. The other song, I Want to Be Ready, I was playing in the Montreal Jubilation Choir. Probably 2000 to 2005, and that was a rocking tune. It was on a live album that we did at a huge church with the choir. That was, I enjoy that one. I mean, I don't know if you want to play a bit of that one.
Yeah, let's do it. Let's do it right now.
You can just play a bit of it.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, all the same things you've been talking about. You know, feel and groove and syncopation and energy and hook up with the band.
Yeah. And I think that if I could put that in a nutshell with how I play with you and how I play, you know, how we play like here, all the jazz stuff that we've been playing, it's the same thing, although it's just, you know, directed in more of a jazz like standards way. And it fits your playing perfectly because, you know, I feel that you have a similar way of that same style, that type of approach. You know, you want to make people, you want to affect people in a way that lifts their spirit, you know, and by doing that, it's not always by like how much you're playing. It's how you feel about how you're playing. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Cool. I like that. That's so true. It is the feeling that you're communicating. That's
You said it once to me. You said it not too long ago. You said to me, you know, sometimes, you know, if you feel that you need to play something a bit more, you'll opt for a bit less in order to keep the groove going. And I really appreciated when you said that to me.
Ah.
Because I don't know if you remember that.
Sure, maybe.
Yeah, I always try to opt out to try to just keep the groove going rather than try to play more because, you know, you get into trouble that way, you know?
Amen. So true. Well, tell you what, the proof is in the pudding. So maybe while I tell everyone what a pleasure it's been for me to get to hear this, Peter, to hear your, you know, formative music, some of the music that brought you to where you are today. And we just thank you so much for taking the time to put together your playlist. I also have one question that I'd like to ask you that we get to ask everyone who comes on the show, which is, so what's keeping you inspired today when you're playing in this time when we're not actually physically making grooves together? What's keeping you occupied? What's inspiring your playing and your message day to day?
Well, you know, I mean, in a nutshell, probably, I've enjoyed such a wonderful time the past few years of meeting all the great players here in town and getting to play a lot lately. It's been so fantastic. And I think that I look forward to doing it more in the future. I think that I look forward to the future when we can do it again.
Yeah. All right. Well, hey, so Christine has brought up a tune. I'm going to suggest that we start maybe around the halfway or two-thirds of the way through, Christine, and we'll just see what it is. It's going to be brand new for you and me, and we'll just see what we did back on March 10th.
Okay.
And thank you, everyone, so much for joining us. This has been Tuesday Night Jazz at the Church with our very special guest, Peter Dowse, P-Dog Diddy Dowse. Such a pleasure, Peter. And thank you so much for Christine Chapea for helping make all this stuff happen behind the scenes. So this is a piece we did called The Heights, and who knows? Two-thirds of the way, we're probably in a sax solo or something. Let's check it out. Thank you. Oh, there you go. Well, Peter, it was great to hear your quarter note. I've missed it. It was nice to hear it there for a second. Thank you so much.
That was fantastic. I wouldn't have never known that was us playing.
Yeah, well, I'll send you it. That was a little unmixed concert we did, the last concert we did for an audience at Tuesday Night Jazz at the Church. That was, we came in on Roy Stife's tenor solo, and then we went to Brent Jarvis's piano solo, and Miguel joined us for the head out there. So Peter, thank you so much for all the music you've given Victoria in the last few years and all over the world, and your many, many recordings and concerts. We thank you so much, and we look forward to playing with you again soon. And thank you to all of you for tuning in tonight at Tuesday Night Jazz at the Church. Please join us next week. We've got some great upcoming programming coming for you, and hopefully we'll be able to get back into the sanctuary and start making music that we can all share with you very soon. Thank you again so much for Christine Chaffea, and so much Peter Dowse, our special guest, and all of you for joining us. Thank you so much. Stay well, and good night.
Thank you.
Thanks, P-Dog.
Thank you.